Michelle Tepper is an itinerant speaker for Ravi Zacharias International Ministries, teaching worldwide on a number of subjects, including the problem of pain, God's character, the dignity of women, and questions about morality, sexuality, and love. She earned her bachelor's degree in political science from Stetson University, studied abroad at Oxford University, and pursued further theological studies at the Oxford Center for Christian Apologetics. Prior to joining the RZIM staff, she worked with her husband Peter for 6 years as a university chaplain for St. Aldate's, a historic Anglican church located in the heart of Oxford. Please welcome Michelle Tepper.
It is so great to be with you guys. They gave me the after lunch slot and they figured let's talk about sex to keep everybody awake. So I hope that you are ready. We have heard so much and we are not done yet. So mind the gap. How do we break the silence on love, sex, and relationship? These big ticket, hot button issues. With confidence and with hope. Can the biblical standards for relationship still be realistically upheld today? And I have a feeling, based on listening just to the movement and the amens and the yeses and the Twitter feed, that most of you guys in here agree, obviously. Yes, we're all for those standards. But affirming that publicly is one thing. Affirming that in our lives is one thing. If we truly believe that these standards can be realistically upheld and that they are good news for everyone, how do we confidently engage in these important subjects in a way that offers hope, freedom, and fulfillment for our hearts, for our children's hearts, for our friends' hearts, for our world? Well, the first thing we have to do, the first point is already up there. We have got to mind the gaps. For 13 years, I studied and worked and pastored just outside of London. My family and I have only just moved back from a decade living in Oxford and then 3 years just outside of London to the US over a year ago. So I'm still settling in myself. And really, if you've been out across the Atlantic on that side, often the only option for transportation was the tube, right? Or the underground, or the subway. You pick your term for it. And one of the world's oldest and largest underground transportation networks are the ones that are in London. It's estimated that 4.8 million passengers from every, and literally every imaginable background, if you have been down in the belly of London, travels on the tube every single day. And before every single train departs, if you've been there, you hear this nice little warning, please mind the gaps, right? After 13 years there, you would think my accent would be better. It's not. I'm sorry. I'm just not one of those accent type of people, okay? And you see, for Transport for London, or TfL as they're affectionately known there, they understand that it doesn't matter how reliable or efficient their transportation system is. It does not matter how much evidence they can give you saying this is the best method. Don't try to drive in London. Not only will we smack you with the biggest tax that you have ever paid in your life to drive there, but it's going to be super slow and really frustrating. You might hit a cyclist. So no matter how much evidence they provide you for saying this is the best method of transportation, it doesn't matter if a person never makes it on to that train, if they fall into the giant gap, and it is a giant gap in some of them, between the step from the platform onto the train itself. And you know what? It can be easy to forget this really important bit of advice when it comes to the journey of faith with people. Now, gaps create obstacles instability, fear, and opportunity. I don't think that we need to fear gaps. I don't think that we need to be afraid of gaps, but I want to talk about what I mean with minding the gaps before we dig into this subject of love, sex, and relationships. This whole conference, AMP, has been about not only getting all of the right factoids of apologetics, but how we translate them into our everyday conversations. And you see, it's never going to be enough to build a rock-solid systematic defense of biblical morality, because really that's what love, sex, and relationship touches on, without realizing that there are huge gaps in meaning, in experience, and in relationships that people have been through that we have to not only be aware of when we're speaking to someone, when someone asks us a question about the dreaded subject of sex, of marriage, of love, of relationships, of dating. You fill in the blank when your stomach just flips and goes, why couldn't they have asked me the question about the ice caps? Now I'm ready for that. I'd rather talk about that. Instead, we have to be aware, not only aware of these gaps, prepared for them, and personally responsible with them when we engage with our world. And to truly mind the gaps, you have to seek them out. You have to become familiar with them. You have to be comfortable with them. You have to be made aware of them. And that never stops happening in our lives. And the best way to become familiar and confident with these gaps that we're going to have to mind in our everyday apologetics, in amping up our not only our understanding of the big questions, but our ability to translate them, is to become familiar and confident through the means of what? Everyday conversation. Practice. So we have to mind the gaps first, but then we have got to break the silence. And for the rest of our time, I want to paint a picture of how it's kind of easy to do this on these subjects of love, sex, and relationship, even though they can be really scary, even though we can go, oh no, but how? Am I going to get in an argument? Am I going to never be able to speak to my friend or my child or my colleague again? Will I be deemed as the homophobic or the unfun or the anti-love, uptight person in my workplace? The way that we move forward after we realize that there's going to be potential gaps in meaning and experience, and we have to tread carefully and we have to be prepared with them, we have to just learn to break the silence. How do we do that? Well, I don't know if you've come across the book by David Kinnaman, You Lost Me. It's a really important book talking about where we are at in kind of our church lifestyles and our day-to-day lifestyles. But he says this. He says 6 out of 10 young people leave the church after age 15. And he deems young people, he's very generous, between 15 all the way up to the mid to late 20s. Okay? They leave the church after the age of 15 for these main reasons. Isolationism. They think that the church, Christians, not only do they not want to break the silence on this, but they keep everybody in a bubble. They say, just stay back here and don't interact with the world. For shallowness, that if you're in the church, they don't go deep on these big subjects, that the church is anti-science. He obviously hasn't been to the AMP conference, right? That the church is exclusive, that they're not safe to voice their doubts. And guess what? Lo and behold, one of the main reasons is this whole idea of sex, love, and relationships. And it's interesting that in a culture that equates sexual freedom, which right now we are living in a moment, I would say almost as never before, where we equate sexual freedom, and when I say we say our giant world, okay, maybe you don't personally, but a culture that equates sexual freedom with identity and satisfaction, if we are living in that moment where they say, I get my main reason for identity, I define myself by my practice and freedom in my sexual life. I know who I am, and I get my satisfaction thereby. And in a cultural moment that is shouting that from the rooftops, the biblical standards for sexuality are often viewed as both personally offensive to the person that says, you're going to tell me to stop this, and this is how I define my life? This is how I know who I am? They're not only personally offensive, but they are shockingly restrictive. Maybe the question comes this way. If God is love, why would he put so many restrictions on the way that we can pursue and practice love? I thought the message is all about love, but you're telling me to come to a God who is going to restrict and shut down my love life. And because of this and many other reasons, maybe I'm just scratching barely the surface, you're going, you're not even touching the hot topic areas. Because of this, it can be really easy to fall silent on topics like love, sex, or relationships. To maybe go, that's not even an apologetic thing. I mean, really, let's just talk about all of the other things we've been talking about. These are just something other. Maybe we save that for a counselor. Maybe we save that for a one-on-one girls' night. Maybe we save that for you fill in the blanks. It's too easy to fall silent on these because we think, I don't know how this person is going to react. The gap seems too large or dangerous without risking self-destruction in your conversation about that. I don't know if you felt that way. I don't know if you've gone, okay, I will arm myself with, you know, things about the Bible. I will arm myself with things about the resurrection, even science. I mean, I'm coming away from here going, I love this. And we got great examples. But if I cross into that territory of speaking to you, fill in the person in your life about their love life, all of the ground that I've built for a case for Christ, all of the relationship I've built up over years of loving this person, if I touch their love life, if I question that, there goes my evangelistic opportunity. It's right out the window. But you know what I have found and what we are finding around the world? People want to talk about this issue. People are desperate. People are leaving the church because nobody wants to talk about this issue. And they're going, somebody mention the elephant in the room. Hello, will you talk to me? So one of the best ways of minding the gaps and moving forward and being able to build the bridges, which is what we've been talking about, is first we must just go, okay, this is going to be scary, but I am going to break the silence. So how do we not only confidently break the silence on these issues, but also build beautiful bridges that will help us move forward on these important topics in a way that offers hope? And I'm going to keep coming back to this. In a way that offers hope, freedom, and fulfillment. Is that too tall of an offer? Well, I'll tell you what. I was at Arizona State University just last week. 98,000 students. 98,000 students. We talked about everybody. We had Dr. Zacharias in speaking about Jesus among secular gods. We had Dr. Vince Vitale. They've just written their book. We had scientists and we had many people in. And yet on Thursday night, as I spoke about will we ever be satisfied, the room was packed. Lo and behold, into the shock of our media department, two different people Facebook Lived almost my entire talk, and by the end of it, there was over 400 views. People tuning in for almost 40 minutes. Why? Because I am so good? No, you've heard Dr. Zacharias. You know that's not the truth. Because people want us to break the silence. People want to go, you are painting a picture of a God of love. You are painting a picture of a real historical Jesus. You are painting a picture of a God and a worldview that actually it meets all of my scientific questions. It's touching on suffering in a way that nothing else can. But what about my love life? But what about the cost in it for me? We have to break the silence. And once we break the silence, we must be able to then build beautiful bridges that offer hope, freedom, and fulfillment. How do we do that? I'm going to give you a few examples today, and then you can ask more questions afterwards in the panel. You know what? Although we are supposedly living in the most sexually inclusive and limitless time in history, what do I mean by that? Pretty much, as never before, modern society is saying, you define sex, you define gender, you define practice. There are no limits. You do you. We're not going to restrict it, and we accept how you are. Although we are living, as never before, arguably in a place where that is fine and celebrated and fought for around most of modern Western society, why is it that it seems that as a culture, we're just as disappointed and confused as ever about love? You ever thought about that? That's one of the easiest ways to build bridges, because generally people will give you that point. Vanity Fair, if you don't want to take my words for it. This article, and this was their spread. It's called Tinder and the Dawn of the Dating Apocalypse. If you don't know what Tinder is, it's not really important, okay? Someone in Canada asked if it was food. It's not, all right? And they wrote a whole article, a woman called Nancy Jo Sales, where she talks about what it's like, this apocalypse we are living in right now, where you have this limitless freedom and availability. You can define love, sex, and the practice thereof however you want, but where have we come to as a culture? This is how we begin to build bridges. Let me just read a small quote about where she says that total relational freedom may lead our culture. What happens after you've come of age in the age of Tinder? Can men and women ever find true intimacy in a world where communication is mediated by screens? Or trust, where they know that their partner has an array of other easily accessible options? In a perfect world, we'd all have sex with whomever we want, and nobody would mind or be judged or get dumped. But what about jealousy? What about sexism? Not to mention the still flickering chance that somebody might actually fall in love. This isn't a preacher. This is Vanity Fair. You will find when you begin to confidently even just tiptoe into breaking the silence, how's your love life? Have a relationship? How are you feeling these days? That once you break the silence and invite someone to share their story of where they're at, it is pretty easy to build bridges to the gospel on the topic of love, sex, and relationship. Let's go with just this idea, where the question is, if we've gotten everything we wanted, what about love anymore? Once you start to build a bridge, and as you've seen on that video that we saw at the beginning of this morning and the beginning of yesterday, building the bridge is only the first part. We then must be willing to put in the time to journey together with people. It's not enough just to build a bridge, a beautiful bridge, going, oh, you thought the gospel didn't connect with this over here? Look, let me build a bridge for you. Great. That bridge might seem terrifyingly shaky for someone. Actually, you might be building the bridge of belief and faith in a God of love step by step as you live out the fact of that God of love with them. So how do we journey together with people once we break the silence on the idea of love, sex, and relationships? Well, here's just a few things you can do. First off, and you've heard this 1,000 times, so write it down again, because obviously it must be important if we're all repeating ourselves. Listen to their story. Ask them where they are at in their love and relationships, and don't be afraid. And then let them tell you. I guarantee you, the variety of where people are at in their relational experience varies by as many people as we have on this planet. It doesn't take much for someone to share with you a story of their childhood. That's a love relationship. It's not all about sex and love, okay? A teacher, a parent, a mentor, a best friend, bullying in school or on the job. Ask them their stories of relationships and ask good questions and leave room for them to ask theirs. What are some of these follow-up questions you can be asking on this topic to begin to journey with people on this idea of love, sex, and relationship? So if you bring up, really, okay, so we're living in this free access society with love, sex, and relationship, and yet it seems like we're just as dissatisfied as ever before. Is true love even possible? Do you know those are one of the talks that get packed out more than anything else in the university campuses we're going to? Is true love even possible? People want to talk about that for days.
Guess what? I've just asked a total gospel question without going, do you know Jesus Christ? You've just opened the door to hours of conversation. Is true love possible? Once you get them talking about whether or not they've given up on true love, whether it's just a myth, whether it's a fairy tale, whether they hate love and they are done with it and they're focusing on them and themselves, what about a follow-up question to that? Well, if you think true love is possible, what is love? Did you know that in 2012, the top search on Google internationally was what is love? The top search. What does that tell you? It tells you lots of things, but for me, at least two things. Nobody knows what love is, and everybody is looking at it. Talk about a unifying theme to open doors. Nobody knows what love is, and everybody is trying to find it. And you could just push doors for days on that. The way that a person understands or defines love, whether they realize it or not, will directly influence how they experience and pursue it. The way a person defines love, whether or not they realize it, will automatically influence how they experience and pursue it. So you can go there for days. You're talking to the naturalist. There is no meaning. Love is just a chemical process in our brains. Well, let's follow that through on how you've been pursuing it. What do you do about fidelity? What do you do? Does it feel good if love is just cold? You have to push things to their extremes for long just to get people to think about how do I define love? Does it match up with the way that I'm pursuing it? With how satisfied I am. Is love just a subjective feeling? And if so, how do we feel about love and pursuing relationships with like nothing more than a consumer sport, like shopping, where we use people, trying them on to see if they fit, searching for the best option at the least amount of cost to us, trying them on again and again and again, and eventually maybe discarding them and moving on if they don't fit any longer, if we find a better model or a better view. What is love? This is how we begin to journey together. This is how we begin to invite people in, for them to tell, resonate, lament with them about their experiences of love and life. Another good question is, how do you think we all got here? And what do I mean by here? You're like, uh-oh, this is dangerous. We're talking about love, sex, and relationships. You want to ask that question? No, no, no. It's okay. This is safe for the little ears, okay? How did we get to this point in society where we have arguably limitless access, limitless ability to define love and relationship however we want to, with people championing us to do that, and yet our level of dissatisfaction? How did we get to this point? Well, when we don't know how to define love, it's kind of an easy thing to start pushing through to what we have tried to and how we have tried to define love with leading us to this point. Maybe we've gotten here because in our culture where we don't think that we need religion or God anymore, we have actually made the pursuit of love God itself. Now, a man called Ernest Becker, maybe you've come across him before, wrote something called The Denial of Death in 1973. It was a work of psychology and philosophy. And his basic premise here, and I love to even just open this up briefly with people in everyday conversation. His basic premise is, since we now know, and he was an atheist, by the way, if you're not familiar with him, since we now know that there is no God and we don't need God, what has happened is human beings have been trying to fix their urge for the eternal, their desire for the eternal, even though it's not there, onto something else to fulfill them. And one of his things is called the romantic solution. He basically says that since we have denied the existence of God, but we hunger for the eternal and the heroic in our lives, we have fixed our desire for the eternal on a human being. We have placed all of our hopes and our dreams, spirituality at one point, he says, which once belonged to a different dimension of things, we have brought down and focused on an individual human being. Maybe we've gotten here because we have made the pursuit of love God itself. And if your person that you're talking to in the coffee shop goes, ah, there you go, Christian, no way, that's a little bit too intense. I don't think anyone's God. You don't need Ernest Becker to say it. There's a thousand things in culture, from Bruno Mars, makes you feel like you've been locked out of paradise for too long, to the Hoosiers, Take Me to Church, to my personal favorite recently. I don't know if there are any country fans out there, but I just moved back to Florida. There are a lot of country fans there. There's a band called Florida Georgia Line. I don't know if there's any people there that love them. Okay. So their song, just so that you don't have to take mine or Ernest Becker's view, Holy. Listen to this. I think.
Saving grace, you're my kind of church. You're holy.
That's not a worship song. You made the brightest days from the darkest nights. You're the riverbanks where I was baptized, cleansed all the demons that were killing my freedom. You're the healing hands where it used to hurt. You're my saving grace. You're my kind of church. You're holy. Maybe we have gotten to this place of desperation, of cycling through person after person after person with what we thought would give us full satisfaction and yet left us more hungry than ever, is because we have fixed our urge for the divine on a person. Perhaps as we begin to journey down these bridges with these questions with people, we can point to how it's funny, maybe, how this type of romantic apocalypse we find ourselves in as a culture without boundaries is acknowledged and explained again and again at the heart of the Christian worldview. Because you see, the gospel, the good news is that there is a God. And this God is not far off. He's not removed. He is a God of love. A God who defines love by his very nature. A God who has been eternal, selfless community for all times. Where we know that that true love exists because he exists as he has always existed. Always about relationship. Always about the other. Ever life-giving. Always about sacrifice for the other. Not consuming and consumption for his benefit. And eternal. And we know that that's more than a myth, because that God of love came to us in history. He proved not only the existence of this God of love, but then he proved the character of the selfless, true, loving God by the way he loved, by the way he reached out, by the way he fulfilled, and then by the way he conquered the death to prove that that love, that urge for the eternal true love, is really more than a fairy tale. And see, the Christian message, as we begin to journey with these people down these heart cries, says that our disordered desires for God has resulted in a disordered and destructive desire for other people. And that God came, he sent Jesus to go, it doesn't matter how broken your selfishness has become, has left you or other people, I am coming to show you that my offer of love is still for you. I am coming to say you have not and cannot mess things up too badly, where I cannot come and say what you threw out thinking it would restrict you, maybe is all you've ever needed to truly be satisfied. And at that point, as we begin to journey with people, the last thing that we have to do is say, come and see. Come and see. You see, we have to tell our story honestly, because I don't know about you. This is a picture of one rendition of the adulterous woman coming to Jesus. I don't know about you, but when I hear the story of the adulterous woman, I see some beautiful things about what Jesus says to our culture and to my own life about love, sex, and relationship. It shows me a God who is radically inclusive, a God who looks at a person who was a sexual outsider and says, I see past what you've done. I see past how your broken desire for love has left you broken and broken other people. And I say, come close. I see you. And then I see a God that although he is radically inclusive, he also makes a sacrifice that is completely freeing. That says you're not defined by the way you've practiced your sexuality. You're not defined by the way that you practice broken love. I have come and sacrificed myself to fix the brokenness that you have done. And as you see yourself and accept yourself the way I do and come to believe I am all that I say that I am, I will free you from everything that your definition and society's definition of sexuality and your practice thereof has put and spoke shame and guilt over your life. I will give you an identity based in my love and the reality of who I am that is not tossing and turning based on your feelings or based on society or based on your relationship status on social media. He's radically inclusive. He's completely freeing through his sacrifice. And then relationship with him is eternally satisfying. The last thing we have to do is say, come and see. Come and see a man that told me everything I knew. Two stories in John. We see John chapter 4, right? The Samaritan woman. And we see John chapter 8, the way he treats the woman at the well. One of the most powerful things you can do on this topic is tell your story honestly. Do you really believe that the biblical standards for relationship can still be realistically upheld today? And if so, journey with a person. Ask them their story. Tell them how you have wrestled with it, because we have all wrestled in some way, shape, or form based on Jesus' standards for sexuality, which we can talk about in the panel later. He sets out a standard that when we compare ourselves to it, at some season in our lives, we have all been the adulterous woman. His definition of love and marriage being between a man and a woman, sexual union being for marriage alone, and then it being forever, some way, shape, or form, all of us have fallen within the category of being the adulterous woman. And the reason we're standing here today and that we can invite people to say, come and see, to mind the gaps, to break the silence, to journey with them, and then invite them, is because we can say, I was that woman. He brought me in. His love and his cross and his reality has changed my life, and I want to walk with you as you probe these questions for yourself. Thank you so much.